Жаһанда яхшылык кылган кишини Алла кишини Алла жаһанда яхшылык кылган кишини Алла кишини Yamanlık kılgan kişini kayan badem Allah kayan badem Allah kayan badem Ah bir edemez hiç ki
Alexander the Great, Marco Polo, Genghis Khan's Mongol warriors, mullahs, monks, and merchants all traveled the ancient Silk Road in search of fame and fortune. The legendary Silk Road connected China with Central Asia, India, the Middle East, and Europe. It was history's most famous and fabulous trade route. The Silk Road was not just one road. It was a web of meandering trade routes. A major portion passed through Xinjiang, China's largest province. There, the Silk Road split into two trails, bypassing the treacherous Taklamakan Desert. The two trails met again in the old trading town of Kashgar, also known as Kashi. From there, the Silk Road continued over the roof of the world, through the perilous Wakhan Corridor in Afghanistan, onwards to Persia, past the fabled cities of Tashkent, Samarkand, and Bukhara. After the Sahara, the Taklamakan Desert is the second largest desert in the world. Its ever-shifting dunes continually morph its shape and size. For millennia, the treacherous Taklamakan Desert, also called the Sea of Death, has, like a voracious beast, devoured cities and entire ancient civilizations, only to discharge them in ruins after having buried them for centuries under its forever wind-blown sands. At the beginning of the 20th century, Sven Hedin, the acclaimed Swedish explorer, discovered Lulan. Once upon a time, it was one of the 36 flourishing kingdoms of Xinjiang, the mythical western region of China. Perfectly preserved mummified corpses were among the many archaeological discoveries. Modern science made it possible to recreate the face of a female mummy, now known as the Beauty of Lulan. Not only ruins have been discovered in the desert, but the shifting sands have also revealed spectacular, vast, petrified forests with thousands of silicate trees. Strenuous efforts have been made to rein in the moving sand dunes by planting tamarisk shrubs and golden leaf poplar trees, which have a remarkable endurance against the extreme temperature changes, droughts, floods, and fiercely blowing sandstorms. However, it is a losing battle against the forces of nature. In the end, the ominous desert always wins and continues its ferocious expansion. Due to climate change, perhaps brought on by global warming, the environmental condition of the Taklamakan Desert is deteriorating. In the mountain ranges, the glaciers are shrinking, the snow line is rising, wetlands are dwindling, and the desert is growing. Unlike most deserts, the Taklamakan has multiple rivers which flow into the desert. These rivers washed down from the melting snow and glacier-covered mountain ranges towering around the desert. The rivers create lakes and oases in the middle of the desert before oozing away in the endless sea of sand, forming underground streams. Since time immemorial, the Lopnur people have made an isolated living fishing in the lakes formed by the rivers which flow down from the icy mountains. The Turpan Basin, also called the Flaming Land, is the hottest area in China. Despite its scorching temperatures, Turpan has a booming agriculture. Surrounding the well-tended fields like vultures, the majestic sand dunes in the Taklamakan are threatening to engulf the protective forest belt and devour the fertile land. Built on a lofty mesa, strategically protected by two rivers and towering cliffs, the ancient city of Jiao vanished from the journals of history at the end of the 13th century. After a long siege and a bloody war, the city was looted and completely destroyed. Rich archaeological treasures reveal the prosperous civilization which made this city a jewel under the blazing sun. The city of Jiao is one of the many ancient ruined cities in vast, rugged, beautiful, and mysterious Xinjiang, China's largest province, which only has a population of about 20 million. Situated in the heart of Central Asia, Xinjiang is also known as the Uyghur Autonomous Region. The Great Wall and the Beijing-Hangzhou Grand Canal are two world-famous man-made marvels of ancient Chinese architecture. A third is the Kerez, a unique and extremely large underground irrigation system of wells and tunnels which takes advantage of local hydrographical characteristics based on the waters from the many underground snowmelt rivers. This ingenious system ensures that the subterranean water, which is cool and unpolluted, will not be evaporated by the extreme external heat and strong winds. This engineering miracle has a history of over 2,000 years and irrigates the prosperous Turpan agriculture. The muezzin's call for prayer echoes across the lush valley and the ancient city as the world-famous succulent seedless grapes of Turpan are picked and another bumper harvest is celebrated under the grape trellis with song and dance in the Uyghur tradition of the so-called meshlep. There are large and small meshleps. Typically, the large meshleps take place at weddings, major holidays, and receptions for important guests. Everyone dresses in splendid costumes and enjoys the grand event. The fresh grapes are also naturally dried in so-called shadow houses. These two-story adobe structures are constructed with walls which have many small holes, allowing the hot desert air to pass through and dry the grapes. This process takes about 40 days and preserves the chlorophyll and natural color of the grapes. Not only do these delicious grapes please the most discriminating palates, they also produce fine vintages for wine connoisseurs all over the world. These organic raisins are a true delicacy. Not far from Turpan, we find the Amin Minaret. It is 37 meters high and made of mud bricks and wood. It is richly decorated with 15 different Islamic designs. The structure was built in 1777 by the grateful son of a king in praise of his father's wise rule. Hidden in the so-called Flaming Mountains, are the thousand Buddha grottos of Bezkalik. They have been damaged and looted by grave robbers, raiders, and archaeologists who peeled off many of the priceless murals depicting the stories from Buddhist sutras. Since 1982, these archaeological wonders have been protected historic sites. As the fierce winds continue to blow across the barren desert, we follow the caravan past ruined beacon towers. These solitary smoke signal towers are a legacy of ancient Chinese defenses, which extended beyond the Great Wall. The imperial smoke signals were an early warning system, alerting the various Chinese military garrisons of advancing, marauding enemy hordes which raided the western region for centuries. Mukam is the music of Xinjiang. It celebrates the vibrant culture of the proud Uyghur people. The wild and enthusiastic Mukam presentations are part of any celebration. Mukam is the heartbeat of Xinjiang and a must for every meshlep. Uyghur men and women like to wear beautifully embroidered skullcaps. The women dress in multicolored silk dresses and keep their hair in braids. Traditionally, when Uyghurs greet each other, they do not shake hands but place their right hand on the left side of their chest, bow and say, "I wish you a good fortune." To show special respect in front of distinguished guests or elders, both arms are crossed in front of the chest. Women have their own etiquette. They embrace and touch each other's right cheek and say, "Good fortune." The majority of the Uyghurs are farmers, and the country fair is a welcome way to get together and celebrate. At country fairs, Mukam stimulates the combatants and energizes the crowds. The fiercely fighting rams, who never seem to give up, delight young and old. Mukam also intensifies the vicious dogfights, which are cheered on by excited onlookers. Mukam encourages brave cocks to fight each other, an eye for an eye, like professional heavyweights. These valiant roosters continue to fascinate the crowd with their fighting spirit, as they are repeatedly attacking each other without a moment's rest. Last but not least, Mukam applauds these wrestlers, who are skillfully struggling to throw their opponents to the ground. These good-natured games have a long tradition and are the main attractions of the many country fairs in Xinjiang. Preparations for a Uyghur wedding are being made. Colorful carpets are placed on the ground for the guests to sit on during the feast. The Uyghurs are Muslims. They are well known for their warm and generous hospitality. Naan, the daily bread, and whole roasted sheep are being served to the many guests. The bride is veiled for the wedding ceremony. As tradition demands, the women sit separately from the men. For all to see, the master of ceremony proudly announces the dowry and presents the various gifts, which range from jewelry and cash to household items. As the drumbeat intensifies, the bride at last is led in front of the imam, who performs the wedding rites. After the ceremony, the newlyweds leave the party. Their happy relatives carry the heavy dowry trunk. The party goes on, bursting with the joy of life.
下好的下
我
Engaging entertainment and spontaneous dance continue until late at night. These wonderful, fresh, and natural expressions of life make any celebration in Xinjiang an unforgettable, down-to-earth experience. This is humanity in its most appealing form. Neighbors follow the party with interest as the timeless Mukam beat echoes across the roofs of the city. Kashgar, once known as the Pearl of the Silk Road, still is an important commercial center.Its bazaar and cattle market are famous all over Central Asia. Kashgar's rich architecture and lavish interiors document the wealth of its merchants and artisans who have prospered for centuries by trading and bartering in this strategically located town.These fine skull caps are hand-embroidered masterpieces. This lady is leaving for her daily visit to the bazaar. In this legendary bazaar, exotic goods from all over are admired, bought,bartered and sold. The hat maker expertly demonstrates his skill at the time-honored tradition handed down from generation to generation.Steps away, wood carvers are busy at work. While next door,Fine musical instruments are handcrafted with intricate designs. Food steamers made from bamboo are produced, food steamed in them is free from excessive moisture, which makes it more appealing to the palate. No wonder most Chinese families use them. Here we find metal workers turning out precious copper and brass wares. It's the desire of every man in Xinjiang to own a finely crafted knife or dagger. Traditional methods are strictly adhered to in creating exquisitely decorated masterpieces. In order to make the blade engravings stand out, a special paste is applied. After being reheated, the engravings clearly show on the razor-sharp blades. Pottery is another ancient craft which follows time-honored traditions. The earliest pottery found in Xinjiang dates back over 3,000 years. A special feature of the excavated pottery from burial grounds, tombs, and ruins is the ornamental handles and the black drawings on a rich red background. Each of these artisans tries to differentiate his craft by creating a personal style and design. The daily bread of Xinjiang is called naan. It is baked in these special handmade clay ovens. Naan is made from flour with added salt, sesame seeds, or onions. Sometimes sugar is sprinkled on top. Naan comes in a variety of flavors and shapes and is enjoyed by everyone. Naan is found in the saddlebags of all caravan drivers on their long treks because it lasts for months and is very nourishing. In small country bakeries or on city streets, the non-bakers are constantly at work to please their steady flow of customers. The famous grapes of Trepan, the honeydew and watermelons of Hami, the delicious pomegranates, succulent apricots, apples, peaches, fragrant pears, thin-shelled walnuts and almonds of Xinjiang can be found in season in abundance at any market and are cherished all over China. Another market day is over. The farmers head home past the famous Idka Mosque of Kashgar, the biggest of Xinjiang's many mosques. Built in the harmonious, tranquil beauty of Islamic architecture, it reminds the faithful of their daily prayers. The nearby Apakoya Mausoleum, surrounded by lavish, exquisitely tended rose gardens, was built as a burial shrine and houses richly decorated stone coffins. The Bun Chao Memorial honors Chinese forces which, throughout history, have valiantly defended Xinjiang against marauding warlords. Indo-Germanic Tajiks live at elevations of over 4,000 meters above sea level on the roof of the world. In the fertile valleys, they harvest mountain barley, which is ground in ancient water-powered mills. In their spacious adobe huts, the beds are built around the oven to keep the sleepers warm during the harsh winter months. Their hearty diet consists of meat, butter, yogurt, fresh and dried curds, and a special tea with milk. Tajik women are very talented embroiderers. They embroider the hems of their skirts, the collars and cuffs of their blouses with lovely floral designs. Strikingly beautiful women wear elaborately ornamented pillbox hats. According to local legend, the Tajiks are descendants of the eagle. When celebrating the eagle dance, the Tajiks praise heaven with flutes made from the wing bones of eagles and console the earth with the rhythmic beat of their hand drums. The strategically located stone city was once an important military garrison, customs and courier station on the Silk Road. All caravans on their way east or west through the perilous Wakhan corridor of Afghanistan had to pass through this heavily fortified city, which essentially served as the gateway to the Middle Kingdom. Long ago, the city was destroyed by a devastating earthquake and never rebuilt. This is the mysterious wishing well where young Tajik brides bathe in crystal clear water and pray to the heavens, hoping to have many children. Plenty of fresh water available from the melting snow, which flows down from the surrounding mountain ranges. Old mosques dot the barren landscape, inviting the faithful to prayer. These burial tombs remind us of the many civilizations which have come and gone along the Silk Road. Tajiks are also livestock breeders and herders, and lead a semi-nomadic life. During the summer months, their round white tents are scattered throughout the valleys. Customs and postal messenger stations like this one once served the Silk Road. Now their ruins are relics of a distant past. This part of the ancient Silk Road was once a dirt road. Now it is a modern highway connecting China with Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India. Tajiks have a very special way of greeting and paying their respects. Without a doubt, this school is located at the highest elevation in all of China. The students are eager to learn and excel in their studies. When the school year is over, their proud parents celebrate the diligence of their children with the traditional dance of the eagles against the eternal backdrop of the snow and ice-capped mountain ranges. High up in the mountains, wild yaks are trying to find some grass buried under the snow. Their instincts alert them well in advance when to flee from one of the many deadly avalanches which come crashing down these mountains. In the eternal snow-covered Kunlun Mountains, this Chinese customs station marks the border. The nearby peak Chogori, which stands at 8,611 meters, is the second highest mountain in the world. Xinjiang borders eight countries: Mongolia, Russia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India. "There is a price for gold, but no price for jade," quotes a Chinese proverb. The highly valued Hotan jade is deposited deep in the Kunlun Mountains, and mining it is an arduous task. Jade is a mineral rock which is formed over long geological epochs. Jade is usually wrapped into other stone formations and has to be extracted from them. It is hard to recognize from the outside whether or not common-looking stone formations contain the precious jade. The value of jade, especially white or green jade, lies in its scarcity. Jade can be found at the bottom of seas and riverbeds, in marshland and deep inside mountains. Millennia ago, the roof of the world used to be a huge ocean, which explains its rich deposits of jade. The river of Hotan is well known for its many precious jade stones being washed down from the icy Kunlun mountain ranges. Therefore, every day of the year, people look for stones along the river's edge. Hotan jade is of superb quality and comes in many colors. The famous Hotan jade market attracts buyers and speculators from all over Asia. Deals for top-of-the-line jade stones are made secretly, while lesser jade is openly displayed and traded. The ancient Chinese believed that a dead body clothed in jade pieces sewn together with gold thread would never rot. This belief proved to be wrong, as such corpses clad in jade excavated by archaeologists were all rotten. Only a pile of teeth and bones are left, but the jade clothing itself, made of hundreds of jade pieces, and the gold thread remain perfectly intact. However, this has not diminished the deep-rooted Chinese affection for jade. Personal ornaments, ceremonial vessels, and delicately carved jade figurines have been favored gifts for thousands of years. Jade bracelets are handed down as good luck charms and heirlooms from generation to generation. Jade stone gambling has a long history. Legend has it that about 2,000 years ago, a man named Bian He insisted that a common-looking stone he had found in the mountains contained jade. He presented the stone to his ruler. The king did not believe him, called him a cheat, and had his feet cut off. Another ruler was wise enough to order a craftsman to carefully open the stone, and priceless white jade was revealed. This tale has gone down in history as one of the first cases of jade gambling. China's jade business started with the white jade from Hotan and Xinjiang, but betting on green jade is more popular nowadays. At special events, stones are auctioned off. Speculators must buy the stone as is and as soon as the price is accepted by the seller. It is very hard for speculators to guess the content of the common stones simply by looking at the color of the stone's surface and its shape. Buyers seldom have their acquired stones cut in public to avoid losing face and being ridiculed if the stone they bought does not contain any jade. Many speculators pursue their dream of becoming rich overnight by losing everything. This is a very risky gamble. It greatly differs from other speculative investments. Speculators must be fearless risk takers and have an intimate knowledge of the jade culture. Men with sharp eyes, able to spot the precious jade hidden inside a common-looking stone without the help of technology, are admired and respected experts who make a lot of money. Hotan lanolin jade is especially valued for its smooth shine, fine texture, and its pleasant white color. It is translucent, sometimes even transparent. Exquisitely carved jade figurines and artifacts grace galleries in major cities all over Asia. The Hotan River continues to wash down precious jade from deep inside the forbidding icy mountain ranges. The oasis of Hotan is also known for its carpets. Almost every family in Hotan knows the art of making simple felt carpets. The technique has been handed down from generation to generation. Felt carpets are made by hand using indigenous wool, which is elastic, glossy, and feels soft and fluffy. The wool's natural content of fat mixed with water acts as glue, which holds the felt carpet together after it has been given a special pressure treatment. natural dyes and simple patterns give these felt carpets a special glow and homey look. Felt carpets are inexpensive and can be found in many homes in Xinjiang. Fine yarns, elaborate designs, and high quality of hand-woven Hotan carpets give them a great reputation. For the yarns, a mixture of wool and silk is used to fashion the luxurious carpets, which are highly treasured collector items. Mostly women do the far more complicated carpet weaving. The artful speed and dexterity of their movements is amazing. It takes years to master the skills these women have developed. Most likely, they learned the craft from their mothers, who had been taught by their mothers. The art of carpet weaving is handed down from generation to generation. Small wall carpets depicting scenes of daily life in Xinjiang are favorite gifts. Their designs are quite amusing. Tourists like to purchase them as souvenirs. At home, the carpets will be reminders of Xinjiang's lavish splendor and magic. Silk is a very fine, lustrous fiber spun by the silkworm. The silkworm is the larva of a moth that spins a cocoon of silk. The female moth lays hundreds of eggs on the leaves of mulberry trees. The silkworm voraciously feeds on mulberry leaves and spins its cocoon of silk threads. After about 3 weeks, by breaking its protective cocoon, a mature moth emerges. Shortly before their maturity, the moth must be killed because a broken cocoon means broken silk threads, which have less value. The moths are killed by boiling the cocoons in water. Then the silk threads of several cocoons are carefully reeled together. During this process, it is very important that the silk threads are not torn apart. Thereafter, the yarns are dipped in natural dyes. Their brilliant colors and exquisite patterns create the precious, handmade atlas silk a specialty of Hotan. Silk originated in China. For thousands of years, its production was a well-kept Chinese secret, until the silkworms that produce silk threads as translucent as ice were finally smuggled out of China to Persia by Nestorian Christian monks. This led to Persia discovering the fine art of silk making and demystifying the source of the miracle fabric, which until then was only available from China. However, the most significant commodity carried along the Silk Road was not silk, but religion. The religions introduced on this trans-Asian highway had a more lasting effect on society than anything else. Buddhism from India was introduced to China, followed later by Islam. Both became an integral part of the cultural, artistic, and ethnic makeup of China. These small traditional caps are attached to the headscarves of the women and proudly worn on their daily visits to the bazaar. The bazaars of Central Asia have a long history and are the heartbeat of every town. Mysterious market towns, now buried by the sands of time, thrived along the Silk Road as way stations for exhausted travelers. In the bazaars, goods were bartered, ideas and gossip exchanged, technologies discovered, and as many as 20 languages were spoken, which are now echoes of the past. There is always room for a quick snack of some delicious, locally grown vegetable or fruit, such as these roasted pumpkins or honeydew melons. Time-honored traditions of craftsmanship are still followed by the many artisans. Their crafts have been handed down for generations from father to son. China has long been home to many important inventions. Of these, the compass is among the most influential, as it changed nautical history forever. Chinese alchemists also invented gunpowder. Genghis Khan shocked the besieged citizens of Samarkand and Bukhara when he conquered their fabled cities with his so-called flying fire cannons. This coppersmith creates household utensils which are not only useful, but decorative as well. His son is already busy at work, diligently following his father's instructions. Kettles have been handcrafted since time immemorial and grace many homes in Xinjiang. Every craftsman tries to develop his own design to set his creations apart from the competition next door. Woodcarvers making bowls for daily use from solid pieces of wood. Thank you. The process is simple and fast. In no time, a nice salad bowl is completed. Sesame oil is applied to make the wood shiny, and the ball is ready to be sold. A few doors down, the papermaker is slicing and cutting the bark of mulberry tree branches to make pulp for a special paper. Paper making and paper money were invented in China, as well as typography. On the Silk Road, Chinese paper became an important commodity. Until the end of the 18th century, paper was made by hand in Europe, following traditional Chinese techniques. The handmade paper's texture is treasured by calligraphy artists. The nearby mosque is surrounded by fragrant rose gardens, which not only form a beautiful backdrop for the lovely dancers, but the roses are harvested for their ethereal oils, which are used in sensuous perfumes. Xinjiang produces the finest cotton in China and has a booming textile industry. A superhighway cuts across the desolate Taklamakan Desert, with bridges spanning the rivers from the icy mountains, which meander through the desert and eventually disappear into the endless wasteland of sand. A protective belt of desert-resistant trees and shrubs has been planted. The trees and shrubs are constantly irrigated, but the ferocious desert can only be temporarily stopped in its eternal quest to devour any man-made obstruction. The everlasting desert winds continue to blow the shifting sands across the superhighway, sometimes covering it completely with fine sand, like fresh fallen snow. It seems that only camels miraculously survive in this harsh environment. The vicious Taklamakan Desert has taken its toll on mankind, but now gives back. After years of failed exploration, the desert has finally yielded its well-kept secret and revealed huge deposits of oil and gas. Formerly known as the Sea of Death, the Taklamakan Desert is now referred to as the Sea of Hope. For energy-hungry China, the black gold of the Taklamakan is a blessing. Xinjiang is now an important provider of much-needed energy, with pipelines connecting it to the highly industrialized east of China. Besides oil and gas, the desert has also rich deposits of copper, gold, iron, tungsten, chromium, manganese, saltpeter, and gypsum, which are mined with modern techniques. Huge wild camel herds continue to roam the desert and gather around their watering holes. The world-famous Kizil Grottoes are a complex of 236 caves. About 135 of them remain relatively intact. The rest have been vandalized by grave robbers, plundered by marauding armies and greedy archaeologists who peeled the priceless murals off the walls. In the 3rd century AD, these grottoes were tunneled by monks deep into the rock of the mountains. The exquisite murals depict stories from Buddhist sutras. Interestingly enough, the vivid dance scenes of the murals present the same choreography as is still performed today in Xinjiang's ethnic dances. The famous Iron Gate was built at the top of a pass crossing an insurmountable mountain range. It was a strategic checkpoint on the ancient Silk Road. Travelers had to pay a road tax for the privilege of using the Silk Road. Broken down carts are reminders of the arduous treks the caravan traders had to make to move their precious merchandise across Central Asia. In the 13th century, during the Yuan Dynasty, Emperor Kublai Khan, grandson of Genghis Khan, perfected the postal courier system. His fearless Mongol warriors guarded the Silk Road and guaranteed safe passage for the caravans, which usually traveled by night because in daytime the desert heat was unbearable. The former palace of the commanding general of the military garrison stationed at the Iron Gate is now a museum recounting the bygone glory of the Silk Road. Legend has it that a monk suggested to Genghis Khan that he build a city at an auspicious place on the grassland following the rules of the ultimate, which consists of a black and white fish, also called the yin and yang. The 8 diagrams symbolize the 8 natural phenomena: water, sky, earth, thunder, wind, fire, mountains, and lakes. Genghis Khan passed away before he could realize the vision of the monk. Early in the 20th century, a Chinese government official remembered the legend, and Turkis, also called the Heavenly City, was built according to the monk's suggestions and Genghis Khan's original architectural plans. This brand new city on the vast historic grassland has been blessed with prosperity and good fortune ever since. For centuries, the Tuva Mongols have lived completely isolated, high up in the deep forests of northern Xinjiang, as farmers and livestock breeders. The Tuva claim to be direct descendants of Genghis Khan. The Tuva have preserved the ancient music and traditions of the nation on the back of horses, as the Mongols were called when their raiders swept across Europe, establishing Genghis Khan's gigantic empire a long time ago. Only recently roads have been built and electricity has been provided, which make the land of the Tuva and the outside world more accessible. Satellite television now brings the world into Tuva homes, and tourists start visiting the picturesque area. However, the Tuva continue to live a very simple life. Their villages are scattered in hidden valleys across the densely forested mountain ranges. Some of them are so remote that outsiders rarely interrupt the tranquil daily existence of the villagers. Unlike their nomadic brothers on the endless grassland of Xinjiang, the Tuva live in sturdy wooden block houses with mud-covered roofs shielding them from harsh winters. Like all Mongols, the Tuva are expert horsemen. They seem to have been born in the saddle. Horses are their best friends. The Tuva breed fine horses, which master the rugged mountain trails connecting the remote villages. Their nomadic Mongol brothers from the grassland, who occasionally pass through a tranquil Tuva village, rely on the two-humped Bactrian camels as trusted beasts of burden. The camels are also called boats of the desert. They have the unerring ability to sense water. Wherever water can be found, just beneath the desert surface, the camels will stop. The caravan drivers will dig and for sure will find the life-giving element. Expert horsemanship is the pride and joy of life for every Mongol. The famous horses of the western region were called heavenly horses in ancient times. The Chinese dynasties needed horses for their cavalry and traded fine horses for silk and tea with their nomadic neighbors. On the endless grassland in northern Xinjiang, the Mongols are constantly on the move with their giant herds. They breed and tame horses, count their sheep, and brand cattle. Born lambs are under constant threat by the soaring eagles, patiently circling in the blue sky, searching for prey. Expert horsemanship is a daily exercise celebrated by young and old at competitions all over the grassland. The swan is the holy bird of the Mongols. The Swan Lake is famous for its migratory swans and other rare birds. brown tents of the nomads are quickly erected and provide a cozy home for their large families. On the vast grassland of Xinjiang, the Mongols enjoy the freedom of a unique lifestyle. At night, after a hearty meal of roast mutton, the family and their guests gather around the blazing fire, drinking milk tea. Mesmerized, they listen to legends of victory and defeat in never-ending battles on the vast plains of Central Asia and tales of triumph and loss from the long history of their forever roving ancestors. Archery competitions are very popular in Xinjiang. Archery has a long warrior tradition. In Central Asia, archery has been an essential skill perfected in the hands of clashing warrior hordes for thousands of years. Expert archery was the decisive element in winning the many bloody battles between feuding warlords which raged across the western region. Everyone feared the accuracy and speed of the deadly arrows. Today, master craftsmen recreate the traditional bows and arrows, modeling them exactly after the ancient originals, using the same designs which graced the traditional weapons. The nomadic Kazakhs follow the seasons. When snow covers their grazing land on the higher elevations, they move their camps to lower, less snow-covered areas. Kazakh camps are quickly set up and provide shelter and comfort for their large families. Endlessly, mighty eagles circle the sky, scanning for prey. Suddenly swooping down and soaring up again, clutching in their claws a newly born lamb. At night, the families gather around the glowing embers, entertaining themselves, and the newly born lambs join the merriment. Falconry, the art of hunting game with birds of prey, and the training of these birds has a long tradition in Xinjiang. Not only falcons, but also eagles are used for hunting in Xinjiang. In mythology, the eagle represents might and courage. Since ancient times, the eagle has been a symbol of empire and sovereign power. With spring in the air on the vast grassland of Xinjiang, these Kazakhs prepare to join their friends at lower elevations to celebrate the beginning of a new grazing season. Quickly, camp is broken and the caravan is on its way. Under the warm spring sun, large tent cities sprout up in the grassland. Everyone gathers from all over to partake in the much-anticipated festivities. Young and old display their horsemanship during the exciting spring festival celebrations. Boys excel on unsaddled horses as they chase along at breakneck speeds, eager to outdo one another. Legend has it that the girl chasing game originated when a prince and a swan fairy got married. On their wedding day, riding white stallions, they chased each other on the grassland into a full moon night. Now the game is an expression of special affection between lovers who at the same time celebrate their expert horsemanship to the applause of cheerful onlookers. If a girl only wields her whip over the man's head without really touching him, it is obvious that the girl is in love with him. The match is made not in heaven, but on horseback. Sheep grabbing is a game similar to polo, only that here the object of desire is a sheepskin or even a headless sheep carcass, which the master of ceremony throws on the ground. Two teams rush towards the remains of the sheep, and the fastest rider picks it up. The riders of the other team chase him, trying to grab the sheepskin. His teammates protect him by blocking the rival riders. The rider who has the sheepskin can pass it on to one of his teammates, much like passing the ball in soccer or American football. The game is fiercely fought at lightning speeds by the riders who excel in their amazing horsemanship. The rider who finally manages to throw the remains of the sheep into the basket has won the game for his team. These silent witnesses to never-ending savage battles are dotting the now peaceful grassland. Nobody knows who carved the stones, put them there, or what they mean. These mysterious statues have survived the many battles raging across Xinjiang, which was again and again overrun by marauding armies on horseback, trying to conquer the plains of Central Asia and control the mythical western region of China. Now, terrifying battle cries are just echoes of a distant past. Peace and harmony grace beautiful Xinjiang and its fascinating multi-ethnic culture. Urumqi is the capital of Xinjiang. It was once an important courier station on the Silk Road. Today, it is a modern metropolis with an efficiently run and user-friendly airport, the state-of-the-art Trans-Eurasian Railway, and an extensive freeway system connecting Xinjiang with the rest of China and, ultimately, the world. Urumqi treasures and celebrates the unique cultural diversity of Xinjiang and the legendary Western region. The superhighway of global trade and technology, the flow of knowledge, resources, and logistics linking China with the rest of the world is like a renaissance of the Silk Road's golden era. The Middle Kingdom was once the cradle of civilization. Now China is doing everything it can to preserve its epic culture. It remains to be seen if the remnants of China's rich cultural heritage and time-honored traditions will survive the onslaught of the 21st century.